Am.
Okay. Hi, everybody on Zoom and YouTube Live. Just want to welcome everybody to the USA Hockey webinar series presented by Pure Hockey and BioSteel. We're really excited to have Detroit Red Wings head coach Jeff Blashill on. So first off, Coach Blashill, you played growing up. You were a goalie for Des Moines, and you won a Clark Cup there, and you went to Ferris State. Tell me about your time at Ferris State.
Yeah, no, I had a great experience at Ferris. I had the opportunity to be coached by Bob Daniels and had some great assistants in Drew Famulak and Jamie Russell, and then Mark Kaufman actually recruited me left and has now come back. But it was a great coaching staff. Really, you know, I say this lots, but there's reality to it. I played my first couple of years. By my junior year, I lost my job, and I honestly got a head start in coaching by being a below average goalie, and that might be strong words. So but Bob Daniels would you know, the one thing I thought was awesome was he would always make me feel important. He would come to me on the bench, he would ask me questions as to what I thought in my junior and my senior year when I wasn't playing much, and I wasn't just another player, I was somebody important to the team, even though I wasn't having an impact on the ice. And then ultimately he came up to me during my senior year one day at practice and said, would you like to ever think about coaching? And it was something that I'd really thought about lots, and that kind of started my coaching career. So I owe that staff a lot. I owe Ferris State a lot. I met my wife there, have great friends from there, but I certainly owe my start in coaching to that staff, and specifically Bob Daniels.
So you started coaching there with Ferris State, and where you ended up going to Indiana Ice in the USHL. How was that time there?
Yeah, it was an interesting journey. You know, I went from Ferris then to Miami, and I spent 10 years as an assistant coach in total, and I had 4 years as a coach at Ferris, 6 years as a coach at Miami. And one of the reasons I had left Ferris was everything I knew as a hockey person, everything I really knew as a coach was from my time at Ferris, and I wanted to expand my horizons, and it really felt like the right move to go to Miami, and that experience was awesome. Enrico Blasi was the head coach. Chris Bergeron was the other assistant. We were just three young guys trying to figure it out. And we had lots of battles. We had lots of great discussions. We had lots of great discovery in trying to build that program from a good program into a great program, one that could sustain perennial success. And we did a fairly good job with that. About my sixth year at Miami was my 10th year as a coach, and I was really itching to be a head coach. And I ended up taking a little bit of a leap of faith, and I had a 3-year-old and a 1-year-old at the time, and I left Miami, which was a real comfortable situation, to go to the Indiana Ice and be the head coach in the USHL. And it was a big risk at the time, but the best risk of my life, the best decision I made in my life. It gave me a chance to be a head coach. It's what I wanted to do. And those 2 years at Indy were awesome. Our ownership, Paul Scott, the Scott family, Cindy, Simon, Scott, they were great to work for. And I had a number of really good players in there, and we had lots of success. And I learned a ton during my time there. So it was a great experience.
Yeah, and then you headed over to Western Michigan for the Broncos and the Lawson Lunatics going on there, and won Coach of the Year for all three, the USCHO, College Hockey, and Inside College Hockey. Made it to the NCAA. I'm sure that was pretty fun. I know I remember playing there, and that's just a crazy place to play.
Yeah, you know, when the Western job opened up, at the time I wasn't sure. When I was in India, I'd kind of thought about trying to get into pro hockey, and when that job opened up, I just knew it was a real special place. Western Michigan University is a special place. My background in recruiting was Michigan and Chicago, specifically probably Detroit and Chicago, and it's located right between those two cities, and it just seemed to really be a great fit. And Kathy Beauregard was an excellent boss. She gave me a chance. We had a great year. We had some really good players. Danny DeKaiser was a freshman that year. Luke Witkowski was a sophomore. Matt Tennyson was a sophomore. So we had a really good young group of D-Corps. I was able to still recruit a couple players, Chase Balassi and Shane Birchback, because we had a couple scholarships left. So we were able to help our group out right away, and we had a really, really good year. And honestly, I had planned on being there for 10 to 15 years. I had built a part onto my house, and I really thought that was going to be my life for a long time. We had another young son, so now we have three young children, and I thought I could see ourselves really growing as a family at Western, and I got a call out of the blue from Mike Babcock in Detroit.
Yeah, and then you took the job as assistant coach there, and Detroit, and then going to the head coach of the Grand Rapids Griffins, winning the Calder Cup in your first season and coach of the year in your second season. Tell us what the difference, what's the biggest difference between NCAA and maybe the American Hockey League in coaching at those two levels?
Well, it's actually interesting, the similarities and the what I learned from being a coach in the United States Hockey League and a coach in college hockey, how that prepared me to be a coach in the American League. It was great. You know, certainly in the USHL, it's a league where people go to get to the next level, and they're not there forever. They're there to try to further their careers, and it's the same thing in the American League. So those similarities and how you handle people, how you handle players was really, really helped prepare me. And I think in college, dealing with really, they're almost the same age as a lot of the players you have in the American League. And the difference, the challenges that you have in college can help you in the American League. So I thought it was excellent, excellent training ground to prepare me for that American League job. We were very, very blessed during our time to have not just really good players, but our best players were our best workers, were our best competitors. The only time you win is when your best players are super committed to being team players, to doing the things it takes to win as a team. And our best players did that in GR, and we won a lot of games.
Yeah, I remember when you were coaching there and their video came out from with the Detroit Red Wings about their training camp. And you were speaking to the group of young training camp participants about taking your own path. And, you know, it's something that holds true for all those players and all those people and having your own path. Can you kind of talk about kind of where that speech and talk came from and how it's really, I mean, I see it everywhere now.
Yeah. You know, I've been influenced twice in I don't have lots of signage in my locker rooms. I don't have lots of things. There's been two things. And one I'll speak about now that I've had in almost every locker room I've coached in, and that is the mentality of earn this. And originally it struck me when I watched the movie Saving Private Ryan, which, by the way, I just watched with my 13-year-old boy just this week. I'm not sure if he was ready for all that or not, but it was fun nonetheless. And but the earn this mentality. And then as I further went on in my coaching career, I actually saw a tape of Tom Brady speaking about how he learned kind of the earn this mentality. And they don't have exactly the same meaning, but they really do. And my message to our players was twofold. One, you have to wake up every day like you're trying to earn it. You're not entitled to success in this world. Everybody, I think it's really easy for people to get a little bit of a woe is me attitude, and maybe we don't get the breaks, or that team gets all the breaks, or that, you know, whatever it might be, when in the reality, and I have always said this, if you compare yourself to that guy in Saving Private Ryan who's taken his last breaths on earth, and he says to Matt Damon's character, earn this. If you think about that, what great opportunities you have in life every day, wake up ready to earn them. And it's the same thing that in terms of entitlement, and for it's easy, I think, especially in our league, to get entitled, to feel like you're owed things. In the reality, you're not owed anything in life. You get what you earn. And so that was one of the messages. And then the other message is when it goes right along with that. I don't care if you're a first round pick, if you're a sixth round pick, if you're an unrestricted free agent, the NHL wants the best. And we bring in the best, earn their way into our league. And you might get a few more opportunities if you're a high pick, but that doesn't guarantee a success. The only thing that's going to guarantee a success is if you're waking up every day trying to earn that opportunity. And honestly, in our league, it's relentless. If you're not doing that every day in the league, it spits you out, eats you up and spits you out, and it'll happen fast. And so it's a reminder I say to our players all the time.
Yeah, and that was a message that Scott Clemenson was saying yesterday on the webinar. You know, like you had three other first-round picks. It's, you know, it really holds true no matter if it's NHL, AHL, or whatever level that our players are playing at. So you became the head coach of the Detroit Red Wings, which I'm sure was a thrill being a Detroit-born player, and been coaching there for the last 5 years. And talk about your time there and just being able to coach at Joe Louis and coach at the new spot.
Well, I consider myself really lucky. You know, I was born in Detroit. My dad was a Detroit police officer for 10 years. I grew up in Sault Ste. Marie, was a Detroit Red Wings fan, and now I get to coach my childhood team. I mean, not many people get to do that at the highest level, and that's a it's a really it's a real honor. You know, I've got to I intermingle with the Mike Babcocks, with the Scotty Bowmans, all the past coaches, the Dave Lewis's, and you just get to a connection in those areas. I've had an opportunity to coach Henrik Zetterberg, to coach Pavel Datsyuk, to coach Nicholas Cronwell, having an opportunity as an assistant to coach Nick Lindstrom. And I just think it's to be the last coach at Joe Louis and the first coach at Little Caesars Arena, those are just all awesome opportunities. And that doesn't mean it's been easy every day. This year's well known. We've had our big time struggles, but that's okay. I don't think life is supposed to be easy all the time. And we're obviously going through some of that right now. Life is supposed to be hard. It makes you really, really cherish the moments when you have success. And so, as I've talked to our group lots about during these last couple of years, the important thing when you go through struggles is that you keep grinding, because if you can come out the other end, you're going to be better for it. And I really believe that with our group. So it's been a great honor, but it's also been an excellent learning opportunity. And I know I'm a better person and better coach today because of the things that I've had to go through.
Yeah, that's awesome. And you had some international experience with our USA programs, Hlinka Junior A Challenge, World Junior Championships. And was it two or three men's world championships that you're part of?
I got a chance to coach three men's worlds, prior to this year, the three in a row. And, I'd be remiss if I didn't mention Jimmy Johansson's name and the impact that he's had on USA Hockey, and what an unbelievable mentor he was to me, a friend. And he gave me an opportunity to coach that first men's world team. And I know everybody involved in USA Hockey misses him dearly. But those opportunities were great. I've had a chance to coach some of the best players in the United States, had a chance to compete against the best players in the world. The Men's World Championships, for anybody that has never been to one, if you're a hockey fan and you like to have fun, you should go. It's an awesome atmosphere. The fans go, they have a great time. The European fans are different than North American fans. There's a drum going all the time. It's constant noise. Latvia doesn't care if they're winning 7-1 or losing 7-1. They're cheering and they're going to have a fun night that night. And it's just a great, great atmosphere, but it's unbelievable hockey. And, again, having a chance to coach the players, I've had a chance to coach, to compete the way that we've had a chance to compete. I really believe the U.S. Is going to win a gold medal in the men's world soon. I wish we could have done it in one of the 3 years that I coached the team. Unfortunately, we didn't get there, but I do think those players helped lay the groundwork for a future gold medal, and I know it'll come.
So with tournaments like the World Championships, but also with your team, with Detroit Red Wings, starting from the very beginning and trying to build fundamental habits, how are you building those fundamental habits as the season starts and then goes on throughout the year? And what are you trying to do? And I know this is part of your presentation, so if you want to go from there.
Yeah, I'll pull up my presentation here if you give me one second. I think it's really important. The one thing that I think is real important in building your team is that I'm a big believer in teaching fundamentals and habits over system play. And I'm going to use breakouts to kind of illustrate how we do that here in Detroit. But before I get into that, I just want to make clear that point. I was talking with an NFL head coach last year, and it was interesting. Football is the most static sport or at least one of the most static sports, where there's a stop, there's a start, and it's way different than hockey, which is super fluid. But I was surprised to hear from him, you think of football being all about schematics, schemes, systems. And he said to me, he said, systems never win. Players making plays because they have great fundamentals and habits is what wins. And I thought that was awesome. And it really reiterated to me my beliefs that hockey is extremely fluid. You can't tell people where to stand. You can't tell people exactly what's going to happen. It just doesn't happen that way. Whether that's the NHL or when I'm watching my 14-year-old boy, my 12-year-old daughter, and my 9-year-old boy who all play hockey, it's the same for youth hockey. You have to be able to tell them not where, but why. And to be able to build that mentality of why are we doing this? Why, how am I? Because then they can make the proper reads. And what you're actually doing by teaching fundamentals and habits is really you're increasing their hockey sense. And hockey sense is probably the most important thing when it comes to players having success. So I'm going to use breakouts to illustrate that. And we're going to go through fairly quickly how we do it here in Detroit to build into our system play. And that doesn't mean that we don't teach systems, and it doesn't mean that our guys don't need to be five guys on the same page. But it does mean that the critical habits within those systems, the critical fundamentals, dictates whether or not you have success or don't have success. I've had a chance to be on a number of Zoom calls with NHL coaches over this last 3 or 4 weeks, and it's really been amazing to me to hear their beliefs, how similar they are to mine, how important at the NHL level we bring it to the littlest detail and really pound those details home first in order to have any kind of success as a group. So what we do in Detroit, if I was just to illustrate through breakouts, first we start with the mentality, then we focus on certain fundamentals and habits, and then we focus on structure. And so one of the mentalities that we want to make sure we have, or the most important mentality for breakouts, is the idea that the puck is gold. And it's not just for breakouts for us, it's really for our overall game. But when it comes to breakouts, the puck is gold. You got to make sure that when we get the puck, that there's opportunities to move it to different people. So you got a great close support. Anybody can make a 5-foot pass. So make sure that the puck retriever has people in position to move the puck to and have that kind of support. And got to make sure guys without the puck want the puck. Within that mentality, we have certain fundamentals and habits. And some of the ones I'm going to highlight are highlighted here in red. One is scanning or shoulder check. We call it scanning because it's really all over the ice. But it's extremely important. Probably the most important skill in sport is scanning, knowing what you're going to do with the puck before you get it. It's no different in basketball. What are you going to do with the ball before you get it? In soccer, what are you going to do with the ball before you get it? In baseball, same idea. Scanning and knowing what you're going to do with that puck before you get it's critical. In order to accomplish that, we hammer home shoulder checks, making sure that it's not just one shoulder check, it's multiple shoulder checks. And to do that, you have to drill it into your players over and over and over again so they do it properly. Skating is critical on breakouts. I have skate to support, skate with the puck. We're going to highlight some evasive skating, some ways to create a little bit of space for the puck retriever to gain a little bit of space on the forechecker, and I'll show you a clip that highlights that. The other thing we talk about lots is triangle support amongst our two defensemen and our center. We call them D1, D2, and F1 for us. The first forward back acts like the center, but depending on the level you're playing at, you might just say the center. And triangle support is the most important part of the of building into team breakouts. In your breakout, and it's just the idea of making sure those three guys form the triangle. What the first guy is the puck retriever, then you have your close support guy, and then the other player coming back has to make sure he forms a triangle, and that you have multiple outlets at that point. The last part of fundamentals and habits I'm going to highlight is just the wall play by the wingers, and it's really critical part of today's NHL. There's so much pressure on the forecheck now. The puck ends up on the yellow. It ends up on the dasher. It just is going to happen. No matter how much you want to go tape to tape and pass it out of the middle of the ice, it will end up on the yellow at times. And in fact, we don't call it, like I never say rim the puck. We always say bypass the puck, meaning we're going to get back there as the puck retriever. We're going to see two guys forechecking hard, and we're going to bypass it by them. And the word pass is in there for a reason. We're passing it to our teammate. We're just doing it along the yellow. But to do that, you have to have great wall play. And so the habits and fundamentals of great wall play, getting your butt into the defenseman that's crashing down on you, getting your butt into their hands so that you free your hands up in order to make a play with that puck, making sure that you come back as wingers through the dots and then move towards the wall or towards the puck, depending which direction it goes, making sure that you create that battle high so that you have support ice underneath. That underneath ice is critical when you get that puck. You have to have multiple support options. And so that's part of what we talk about. And all those things then filter into the structure that you see underneath. A lot of what I just spoke about. So then the way that we drill it, and a lot of this I'll show you real examples of drills instead of just talk philosophy, So those on the call can decide what makes sense for them and what they can utilize in their own areas, whatever level they're coaching. So the first thing we do in training camp is we want to make sure we emphasize that mentality that the puck is gold. And there's nothing about this game that looks like a breakout, but it's going to help us tons on the breakout. And so what we do is we put, it's just a team of red X's, a team of black O's, and we draw a line on the ice. We take the net out of there. The goalies are at the other end. We draw a line on the ice, and that's kind of the moat. And there's four O's in that moat. Two O's have to stay in that moat at all times. The other two guys can forecheck. The X's, you have three X's on each side, but they're all working together. So you can pass the puck amongst the three X's on your side, or you can pass the puck across the moat to the three X's on the other side. And it's just about supporting the puck, moving towards the puck, wanting the puck, learning how to provide that best 5 foot pass type support in order, and also buying a little bit of space with the puck, having the poise to buy it with the puck. If the puck goes from one side to the other, two O's return to the middle, the other two O's forecheck, and you're actually then teaching a good forecheck habits as well of stick detail, of angles, and those types of things. So here's what it looks like. This is day one of training camp. We'll play this game. And what I do before I started, what I do with this game is if I just basically in my head, I count turnovers. If the offensive team turns too many pucks over in a short period of time because they've had bad support, I make them skate to the end wall and back. And at the end of this clip, you'll see the defensemen that are in black, the blacks on the outside, they actually start to skate. If you don't create any turnovers as the defensive players, then you have to skate. So here, I'll just play it and let you watch it. You're just going to see guys moving to support the puck. You see good triangles as they're moving to support the puck. There's a turnover, comes back to me. I deliver the puck to another player. And again, where are you doing? What are you doing with the puck before you get it? It teaches great support there. Bad pass, though. They stay on it. They're going to get one more puck. Trying to emphasize that mentality that the puck is gold. Great movement, great triangle there. Good job trying to play keep away. Ultimately bad pass, and now you see the black group will start to coat or start to skate. So that's the mentality portion. The next portion we do, and this would be the type of where you're dividing your team up, whether it's a split forward and D, or what we do lots of times is go the D with the centers to work on a lot of these little skill and habits. If depending on the level of hockey, it might be when you divide up into station type work. The key to this is reps. And so you got to get lots of reps and you got to do it lots. And so what we're going to do here is we're working on that fundamental of scanning or shoulder checking. So I'm going to show you an example from a game of shoulder checking, and then I'll show you an individual drill that we do either in practice, before practice starts, after practice, or even maybe in the middle of practice as part of station work. So here's the play happens. It's slow motion. Hronek's going back for the puck, and as he shoulder checks, he sees not only his options, but the forechecker. So now he's taking an early shoulder check to see what's going to happen out there. Where is my best options? What do I need to do with the puck? Now he sees the forechecker coming towards him, that left Nemeth, and he's able to make a tape-to-tape pass to him, and now we're able to get out of the zone. You'll see another example here. Same idea. Watch the number of shoulder checks in this example. Puck's put in. Hronek shoulder checks once here. I'm going to come back in. He shoulder checks again, scanning the ice, seeing what's available, seeing where the forecheckers are, seeing where his support players are. He knows where his support players are supposed to be. There is the third shoulder check. He needs to make sure they're in the spots they're supposed to be in. He's going to take a fourth shoulder check. He's looking at the far wall. He sees the wingers hugging that wall, so he knows if he can beat the forechecker, he's going to be able to skate up the middle of the ice, which he does here. He's able to skate up the middle of the ice, and now we're able to get out with possession. One more example. Puck's going to get put in here. You're going to see Hronek going back for a puck. He's going to shoulder check, and it's a one-man forecheck against two players. So he knows when he shoulder checks here, if he can draw that forechecker in, he can utilize his partner. So he's got to draw that forechecker. He's got to get the forechecker to turn his feet in the stick to attack him, and then he can utilize his partner. If the forechecker doesn't do that, he can skate it and wheel the net. So here the Philly player uses a stick to get to the inside, and then he uses his partner. Okay, so how do you drill that? So we'll go through this, and this, again, will either be at the beginning of practice. It might be some summer-type stuff, but we're just working on shoulder checks. Now, this doesn't look like a breakout either, but scanning and shoulder checks are relative to everywhere on the ice, not just breakouts. So we're doing this in a setting where we're also able to work on a little bit of shooting, but you can see them working on their shoulder checks, and you overemphasize it. You make them shoulder check. They have to overemphasize the shoulder check. 1, 2, get the puck, deliver the puck, and now we're able to turn it into a little bit of a skill drill with a shot, and they're getting the puck at different spots. A little bit of a skill drill with a shot, and then you can add different elements. There's a shoulder check with some skating and a cutback. Now it looks a little bit more like ozone play, but it doesn't matter. It's working that habit of shoulder checking, that fundamental habit of shoulder checking, that if you're good at it, you're going to know where your options are before you get to the puck every time. One more here that you'll get a look at. This is Lark's giving a shoulder check, little cutback, another shoulder check, little cutback. And again, turns this into an ozone type drill. So it's an offensive drill, but really you're working on the habits of breakouts. Okay, the next one we're going to look at is that evasive skating. So as you see this, I'll show you the clip first and then you'll see the drill. We're going to look at Dennis Cholowski, who's going back for the puck against the New York Rangers. So as he goes back, it's a little double cut move and he gets the puck. So in slow-mo, you're going to see he shoulder checks to his left now. Then he shoulder checks to his right. And now he wants to draw Lemieux in as the forechecker towards the net. So there's a little cut there. And then he cuts back up the wall. Just gives him enough space then to allow him to make that five-foot pass. Allow us to get out of the zone with possession. And that's the difference between leaving with possession or giving the puck back to the other team. So now here's a drill, just those little evasive skating moves, come up, pass it, working on lateral gaps. Again, little evasive skating move. And you're going to turn this into a double evasive skating move. Now as the puck goes in, we're going to take it, and now it's a little cut and then cut back. And just trying to do anything you can as that puck retriever to create a little bit of space on the ice for yourself. Double cut, create that space, and you're out. So from there, we build it to the next spot, and that's working as triangle support. So on this case, we've got just the defenseman. Lots of times we work there with this with D and centers. At the other end would be our wingers working wall work. And here we're just working our goalie touch option. So as we come back, the D just working on sprinting back. We like them to face the glass for as much as they can and then delivering it to the center. But we want them to face the glass for as long as possible so that if they get it, they're able to protect it a little bit, hitting the center. And again, just working a simple drill over and over and over again. Then you get into the game, and now you're just way better at it. So your fundamentals of it are down. You don't have to work on it as a group of five. You work on it to build it. Big, huge believer in building it. And the next part, we do this in day one of training camp, this work on our triangle supports. And now there'll be three players, and we're working on a puck retrieval. In this particular case, we're working on wall bumps. So on these wall bumps, one of our commands when we want the puck as a support player is wall, which means passing it kind of a reverse up the wall. So I'll let you watch the first one. We got four. We call this the Grand Haven breakout retrievals. We got four stations of three players going at the same time. And so what's happening here is we're going to simulate a defenseman stepping, another defenseman retrieving, and then a puck supporter. The original step guy has to then create that triangle and be the pop option in the middle of the ice, the center option. Whether he was the D or the forward doesn't matter. He's got to get back in their interchangeable parts at that point. Puck goes in. Puck retriever draws the forechecker. the wall bump hit the middle. And you see it in the game, same idea, puck retriever, try to draw him in, little wall bump, hit the middle and you're out. Last part of this is just the wall play. And this is critical, critical part of our game. As I said, it ends up on the wall more than any of us would like, but it's the reality of the NHL. And so on this, we want to make sure that our wingers are coming back through the dots. They're climbing high. They're pre-bumping the coach, using their body to free up their hands, and then bumping that puck to the center underneath as the coach rims it to them. So you'll see the two lines are set up. Zadina is going to climb high, wants to get a pre-bump, bump it to that center underneath. That puck retriever goes and shoots. Zadina becomes the center underneath option. Climb high, pre-bump, use your body to free your hands, center underneath, and attack off that. So now the next part that we'll do then is build that into everyday, like, shooting drills that we do. This drill twice a week, probably. So we're talking in three practices, we'll do it twice, some version of this. What I like about this drill is you can really build this any way you want. So in this case, we have everybody in the middle of the ice, all our forwards and D, everybody's in the middle of the ice. We have a coach at the hash mark, a coach at the hash mark on opposite sides. And basically you're working into whatever you want in terms of options. So the first one we're going to do, you'll see, is goalie touch. Now the video that you'll see will actually be two defensemen going back, but it's goalie touch with great habits. Then the players move up the ice. They have an entry, in which case you'll see a drive where a guy's driving the net and a shot. And then you got a little ozone play. And then the next group goes, we'll build it from there. Then we'll work on bypass. On the bypass, we have a defenseman who starts in the red line, tags the blue line, and then pinches. He's going to pinch the winger. The other defenseman's going back to retrieve it. He bypasses it around. We work on that wall play underneath. And then the last one is a wall bump into a two-on-one. So we've built it from the mentality to the individual habits of the players to the triangle support. And now we're building it a little bit more into team play and into a shooting drill that we do all the time. So here's a couple examples of each one. So here's two defensemen going back. Coach rims it, goalie touch. It's over and back to the middle. Drive with a shot from the outside. Then you have a little ozone out of it with a D shot. Man at the net looking for sticks. Same idea here. Rim it, over, back, hit the middle. Great habits, facing the puck, good support, middle drive. Shoot off the pads, look for a rebound. The next one's going to be a bypass. So now on this bypass, we're going to get it. You see the D pinching down on the winger. Got to make it a high battle, bump it underneath. Now on our entry here, we're buying space and giving it back for a 1T. And then the D-men are working on picking those rims off the yellow with a net presence and a third circle presence. You'll see three of these. The demon that pinch now becomes the breakout guy, bypasses it, bump back underneath, buy some space in a 1T. Again, the D that pinch is going to pick this off the yellow, work on getting it off with the net presence in a third circle. One more bypass here. Good wall battle. Stay underneath as the center. That's what we work on. We want our centers to stay underneath. Buy space for a quick shot. And then the last one you'll see two different versions of this one. This is a two-on-one, starts with a wall bump. So this is a wall bump to a forward. The other forward's the winger. The D-man that is the initial first touch is the one who takes the two-on-one. In this case, we have two D. We wall bump to a T and then hit the center. But the original D that touched the puck first is taking that two-on-one. So you're just adding some two-on-ones into your shooting drill. And now you're over and over and over and over again, hammering home those good habits. One more time. Wall bump into a two-on-one and you attack. So just out of one set, you're working on different breakouts. And you can, depending what your team needs to work on, you can change the breakouts in that. You can even add some transition pucks to that. Then the last one I'm going to show you is one that we started doing lots at the end of the year when our puck support got poor. I had a good conversation with Igor Larionov, and I was just talking to Igor about, different philosophies and the things he believed. And one of the things, he talked about was that 5-foot pass and just how in the Russian 5 days and the days going back to his experience in Russian hockey, just the importance of those 5-foot passes and learning how to support. So we just started doing this drill. I called it the KLM 5-on-0. And all it is it's a puck. One of our coaches is going to dump a puck in like an opponent. The five guys are going to go back, and it's 5-on-0. If you have the puck, it doesn't matter what the opponents do. And so the five guys are going to go back. They're going to break it out. They can call any breakout they want. All five guys have to touch the puck as they come up the ice. The only rule I have is the next group that goes can't use the same breakout as the previous group. So all five guys touch it coming up the ice. If I blow my whistle before the far blue, they have to turn. They have to jack it back to the guy who's furthest back towards our own end. He gets the puck, and they got to work to get back to the puck and support. And if either way on the entry, the player has to pass off the middle driver's ass. He's got to pass off his ass. That puck has to go from dot to dot for a shot at that point. And then we blow a whistle for a neutral zone transition. So I think the second and third reps of this are the best. The first one's okay. So here we put the puck in. Ends up being a goalie touch. We go over back with it. So we got to get back to support. But you can just see where the guys are working to support each other. Takes us a while to get to our five guys to touch it. We get the shot, whistle, and then you'll see a neutral zone transition puck. We want to go right up that far side when we can. We drive. We use the D for the shot. Okay, the next example of it. Again, Dan Bosma's in the middle of the ice. The D-man's got to step on him like he would in a game. The other D's got to retrieve the puck. So then our forward goes over for a little over, hits the middle. Good close support. All five guys touch it. I blow the whistle. They jack it back. Comes back up right away, and we're just working on support and attacking up the ice. Pass off the middle driver for a shot, and now you got your transition puck. I didn't tell them what to do on transition. The next step on that, and we did it a couple times, is go all five guys got to touch it on the transition puck too. There's another example. We stand, we force the puck out. Now we make a little wall bump, hit the center who's got good support, winger, other winger with support, jack it back. We attack up the ice. Transition puck. There we go. Make a delay move to that weak side D with net presence. So that's the way, Dave, that's the way that we build from fundamentals into systems. And I just think it's critically important that you're working on those individual fundamentals to make your individuals as good within those systems as possible.
So you have, they're all NHL players that you're working with, and their ability to know the game and read the game and have the context. And, I think we sometimes struggle at the youth level and even probably American Hockey League, NCAA, about knowing the game and knowing that context. How would you build some of those drills that you're doing with your players that might not know, kind of their lines that they need to be taken or the right part of the game? Does that make sense?
It does. I would say the one misconception is that because players play in the NHL, they all have hockey sense, or they all have, and the reality is it's all relative, but they don't. We have players that just like when I watch my 9-year-old son's team, some players are quicker to learn than others. Some players are smarter than others. So I think it's the same, honestly, at any level. And it still comes back to, I would say, reps of those fundamentals. To me, if you rep it out, and when you rep it out, you got to do it right. Like I always say, you're either coaching them to do it right or you're coaching them to do it wrong. So if you have any drill, let's say, for example, so really important to us that when we come back into our zone, that our wingers are coming back through the dot lane. They're not coming down the walls. if you do any drill where you're forcing your guys to come down the walls, then you're actually teaching them to do it wrong. And I'm super, super sensitive to that. I try never to do any drill that teaches players to do it wrong. If you want your guys to stop at the net in a game, then make them stop at the net in practice. If you want your guys to have great breakout habits of shoulder checks in a game, then make them do it in practice. And you rep it out over and over and over. And you're not teaching hockey sense per se in those drills, but you're drilling great habits, and ultimately guys with great habits appear to have hockey sense. Now, the other thing is, you know, one of the games that I didn't show in here that we're going to do next year, we're in a period of R&D. I got this from Babs, R&D. So I've been on the phone with a whole bunch of different NHL coaches, and it's Rob and Do. You rob from other people and then you do it yourself. And that's the reality of it. So I've got a game called Barcelona that I'm going to steal from the Rangers coaching staff that I talked to them about. And it's basically a 3-on-3 game where the nets are around the blue lines in the neutral zone, but they use the red line like it used to be used as offsides. So you have to really work back and support the puck in attack, and they play 3-on-3 or 4-on-4, and it's a lot of close support type scenarios. Well, when you use those small games, you do help create better hockey sense. As I said off the start, the game's super fluid. You can't tell people where to stand, but if you give them the mentality of support, just the mentality of the puck is golden close support, if they have those two mentalities, they'll do it right more than they'll do it wrong.
Yeah, and we play that game a lot, and you know, you could do a cross ice if you need to. You just draw the line down the middle, but there's so many variations that you can do off of those games, and I think it's really, really neat that you can do it at the NHL level, at the NCAA, wherever it is, and help and build it.
I'll speak to one thing on that, Dave. I'll just interrupt you real quick. When I went to the American League, we played a game or two every day, every single day, and at the end of the year, our players said it was the best part of practice. And the same is true in the NHL. I don't do it every day in the NHL. Our practice time in the NHL is so condensed, it's incredible. That's a whole nother subject. We never get to practice. So you can't do it as much as you'd like. I can tell you it's the favorite part of our players. And they it brings the compete level up, brings the work level up. But you can teach unbelievable habits, unbelievable mentalities in those games. And so it's something that we utilize tons in pro hockey, whether it's the American League or the NHL.
Give me one or two examples where you can teach those habits within by maybe changing the game somehow. I know we were just talking about the line, but anything that you have, I know in the game that you showed, the 6-on-4, you have those areas where you only had two people and it forced them to become more of a forecheck and roll, right?
Yeah.
And then on the opposite side, the breakout. Any other type games that you're using that you're switching up maybe a little bit to get something out of it?
Well, we actually, so that Barcelona game, we actually play it a couple different ways. I'll just use that as an example. So we actually usually put the nets at the top of the circles, and we have a coach with pucks on one side and the players on the other side, and they come off the bench. So we play that game more as a transition game, that the minute the puck either gets scored on, crosses that imaginary goal line, boom, it's transitioned the other way. And so now you're actually fighting to get to that offensive ice because the puck is turned over. So you're fighting to get to that offensive ice. So you can use that game as a transition game, or you use that game and add the red line in, use it as a puck support game, which is totally different mentality. The other way that you can do it, and I stole this from Seth Appert, who I think is going to speak in a little bit here from the U.S. national team. They use it as an angle game. So when every time there's a change of players, the one group all three players has to go behind the net, and he gives the puck to one of those guys. So the three players coming off the bench have to get up, and they've got to angle properly, taking away good ice, forcing a bad ice, have great sticks, make yourself long, create those turnovers, stop on people, play on the right side of the puck. So just in one game, you're teaching totally different mentalities out of that game.
How are you before the game starts? You know, you might have the same setup on the game, and you know that maybe your team needs to work on a certain thing. How are you communicating that to your players at that time on what the focus is?
I would say two things I'll comment on, and it just made me think of something else. Practice has to be efficient. you will lose your players' focus if it doesn't move from one thing to the next thing to the next thing to the next thing. You can't, at our level, you can never waste their time, ever. And I'm super, super adamant about that. Our coaches, our assistant coaches, have to know exactly what's going on. They know exactly where the pucks are moved from one drill to the next. I never say, hey, put the pucks over here and you put the pucks there. That's already done before. We've already planned that out. It's way harder at certain youth levels, and I get that for sure. But anything you can do as a coach to make sure that your staff knows exactly what they're doing. I pre-draw most of my drills before I go on the ice. So I've got three boards that are on the bench. I just pick the board up and I show it to them instead of stand at the board and draw with my back to them and try to talk. So I pre-draw all those. Boom, it's here. I tell them exactly at the beginning of practice what we're trying to get out of that practice. And usually my focus is narrow. This is our main focus of practice. We're getting better at angling. We're getting better at breakout habits. We're getting better, whatever that is. We're also going to do a little of this, but this is what our focus is. So I tell them that at the beginning of practice, and I tell them before every drill what the focus is, why we're doing it. We play a 2-on-2 angle game cross ice all the time. And you just have your little key words that are, that is part of your verbiage as your hockey team. So it might be, for us, it's stop on puck, stop on people, make sure we take away good ice, force the bad ice when we play that angle game. So I'll just give them those reminders as we're going in that game of exactly what we're trying to get done. And those little, that verbiage is really important, that you use the same verbiage over and over, and all your coaches do. So when you say to them, pre-bump, they know what pre-bump means. Pre-bump means make contact with the opponent before the puck comes to you. All our guys know that. Our coaches know that, and now we're using the same verbiage.
And how do you guys go about teaching that verbiage? Because I know, on the goalie side of it, right, we have RVH, this and that, but having that common language is super important for coaches and players to know, and even probably parents too.
Yeah, well, for sure. It's not necessarily natural to me. In a sense that, I've had to work. I'm not very creative. So I don't do it great, because the other part is making sure you name your drills, so that if you do a drill over and over again, you should just be able to say, we're going to Boston breakout sequence. They know exactly what you're doing. And the creative part of me come up with good enough names on that. But if your verbiage can be creative at all and unique to you and something that age will remember, whatever that is, I would use that to make your verbiage creative and then just over and over and over and over again. Continue to use it. Make sure your coaches use it. And everybody's super clear. You have to introduce it at some point. At some point you have to say, we have a verbiage, I think it was in there on breakouts, on cutting off. Well, what's cut off mean? What does cutting off mean? So from day one of training camp, we're telling them what cutting off means. Cutting off means the players, when the puck's dumped in, the players that aren't the puck retrievers are all skating to try to basically interfere and make it hard for those forecheckers to get in to give your puck retriever a little bit of time. And so we make that clear on day one, and then we got to continue to say it over and over and over again.
We have a question from one of the attendees. He was asking, suggestions to teach youth players and D-men to play D skating forward through the neutral zone. And I know that, in today's day and age with a lot of these defensemen, they're not skating backwards. They're skating backwards very little. It's all about angling and reloading, as a coach once told me. So how are you teaching those D to use that angling, to use that skating forward?
Well, one of the, it's been something that's been important to us. When I first got to Detroit, we signed Mike Green from Washington. And one of the things I thought, Mike Green's an excellent forward skater. And one of the things Tony Granato, who was running our D at the time, really tried to do, and I think we did a good job, and Mike worked extremely hard at it, was that exactly that, teaching them the lateral, we call it lots of times lateral gap, but it's basically using forward skating with angles to eliminate play. So first off, I'd say when you do angle drills or when you do one-on-ones or when you do any of that stuff, a lot of times to me, it shouldn't be player specific. It shouldn't be, position specific. Like, it drives me a little bit wild if I see 9-year-olds all playing defense. Who knows what they're going to be when they're 19? Why would you just play defense as a 9-year-old? It doesn't make any sense to me, at least in practice. I get it in games, but why in practice? So do angle drills. It would be hard for me to exactly explain it here, but we do tons of angle drills that have nothing to do with position, but they always have to do with skating forwards, managing your speed, taking away good ice, making yourself long with your stick, dragging your stick, we call it, and then pushing down a wall and eliminating space. We do that all the time. We do one where a player basically skates with the, there's players in each opposite corners and guys in the middle of the ice. And there's a guy standing at the neutral zone dot and a guy standing basically at the face-off dot in the end zone. He skates with the puck to the blue line. He passes it to the guy at the neutral zone dot. And then he gets up and he skates forward and he angles down the wall. And you do that over and over. One drill we did specific to defensemen was we did two-on-twos out of the neutral zone. And we would have both the forwards and the D-men that were going in the drill start on the red line right next to each other. And they would, and the D-men would tag the opposite blue line of where the forwards were going. The forwards would get a puck. We would pass it to the, they would curl towards the wide wall. The inside player gets the puck and he has to pass it to the outside player. The D-men skate backwards to the blue line and then they got to get up, skate forwards in tandem and lateral gap on those players and try to eliminate them. And the forwards got to support it, try to lay the puck behind and go get the puck. And you just play it out as a two-on-two. And it's an easy way to teach that lateral gap.
I saw we were doing this these Chalk Talk series on our USA and coach from RPI, he did a USA 2-versus-2, very similar, but kind of in the zone where they came in and it was forcing for their angle and the gap. It was a really good drill. And if you check out YouTube, they should be on it. So it was the RPI coach. I got a question about, you're a goalie, okay, and worked with goalies, grew up, now you're a head coach. And sometimes it's hard for goalies within these drills. Sometimes they're not getting the best shots, or the head coach, maybe parents or other people think the head coach is not thinking about the goalies. How do you personally, as a head coach, now involve your goalies and work with your goalies and make sure that they're getting the proper reps that are important for them?
It's a really good challenge. It's a real challenge. I think I have some of an advantage of the fact that I was a goalie, so I can understand what goalies are going through. You know, I learned how to coach by coaching goalies. I learned the importance of habits and how that if you do repetitive, simple drills over and over, just simple drills over and over, how much better goalies got in their habits. It's amazing. And really, goalies were way ahead of skaters in terms of their approach of doing those, working past boredom and doing those easy drills over and over. So that's how I learned how to coach. And it's a lot of what I'm speaking about today. But I do think it's important. You know, one of the things I'd say to a, if we ever set up a goalie drill, I would never have the goalie make the save and then go in opposite direction of the rebound to face another shot, because that's, you're training them to do it wrong at that point. And so we would always try to set up drills that were realistic. Well, sometimes that can't happen in shooting drills. And honestly, I go to our goalies sometimes and I say, listen, don't follow the rebound, or there are times where the drill's just not for them. And I just tell them, this drill is not for you. But if we do a lot of what I would call stupid drills, at the end of practice, we're going to make sure we're resetting those goalies. We're going to make sure that we grab them and we're doing something that is meant for the goalies so that they walk off the ice with good habits, not with some of those bad habits. Now, you can also be smart about, you know, what happens lots and happens at our level. If you do a drill where it's a 2-on-0, you know, guys, or even 2-on-1s or 3-on-1s, guys will pass the puck and then overpass it and pass it back door. I mean, as a coach, you have command whether you allow that or not. Like, you don't have to allow that. You know, like, how many times do you get to pass it 5 times and then the crease to score? So, like, you can take charge of those situations. And I would just say two things. One, you got to think a little bit like a goalie. If you want your goalies to be great, and I think everybody on this webinar would understand that goalies are probably the most important position, then you got to be respectful of them when you're setting up your drills, and you got to think about the impact it has on the goalie. And number two, sometimes you got to communicate to your goalies and say, this drill's not for you. You got to fight through it. A lot of sometimes small games can be that way where they just got to compete, and that's just the way it is.
Yeah, and I know we've been using a lot of drawing the lines for the creases. And that's always a good way to talk. And, you know, you have the ability to have Coach Jeff Salako work with your goalies, you know. So I know Coach Sal, and he's always probably given some tips of what they need to be focused on and utilizing those goalies to have their focus. You know, maybe Jimmy Howard would be different than, you know, Jonathan Bernier on what their focus is. Let's shift a little bit to you know, what are the two most important qualities that you value in a player?
Well, the most important quality by country mile is character. You know, character to me is a word that gets thrown out there. And, you know, it's too easy to just say character. What does character mean? You know, like when I say character, I mean character of a winner. That doesn't necessarily, there's some really, really nice people out there that aren't necessarily have all those characteristics of a winner. So we've defined character, inner drive, competitiveness, selflessness, swagger. Those are things to me that we look for in players that supersedes everything else. As I said earlier, the teams that win are when you have your best players are your best character guys. Those are special teams. That's how you win. You can only win with character and talent, not one or the other. The second thing would be hockey sense, bar none. You know, skating's been is a real big deal in today's game, 100%. But hockey sense matters most by far. Knowing how to play at the end of the game, as I said earlier, is too fluid to tell people exactly what they're going to do all the time. It just doesn't happen that way. So you have to have players with hockey sense that can sort through the gray. You know, I say lots, we teach black and white. We try to use exact examples. When I show video, I try to make sure it's an exact example of whatever I'm trying to teach. I never show those clips where maybe even as a coaching staff, we'd argue about what players should do. We show exact examples, black and white. Players' job is to work through the gray. The better hockey sense you have, the better chance that your team's going to work through that gray.
How are you, if you were coaching your kids and, you know, their ages are right in that 14 to 9-year-old range, how would you want to, if you were coaching them, or how would you want to try to instill those habits in those youth players as a coach?
Number one thing is create an environment that's gonna increase the kids' passion. That's the number one thing. If kids have passion for the game, they are going to work to get better at it, no matter what it is. If my youngest loves to sing, that's what he loves to do is sing. So that's what he does all the time. He sings. He sings ad nauseum to his parents and his sister and brother. But that's what he loves. If kids love hockey, if they love going to the rink, if they then take that love and they take it home with them because you've increased their passion as a youth coach, that's the number one thing by a country mile. You know, how do you do that? The word fun gets put out there lots, but there's reality. You have to enjoy what you're doing. And so, like, if kids go to the rink and they don't want to practice because it's not fun, that's no good. They have to enjoy it. They got to have fun. But the other thing, and sometimes this is super important for the NHL coaches as it is for youth coaches, you have to make each player feel important. Kids want to do things that they're good at. That's what they want to do. Like, nobody has great passion for something they're terrible at, except maybe me and golf. You know, like, other than that, usually you only do what you love doing, what you're good at. So, like, not every kid's going to be the best kid on his team. And I've seen this. Like, we've had great youth coaches. My kids' youth coaches have been great people. But I've seen it where some players not that good, all of a sudden they don't become important. All of a sudden they know they're not important. Like, they know when nobody thinks they're any good, and they lose their passion for the game. So find a way as a coach to try to make every player feel important in some way. Give them roles. Give them something that you're going to make them feel important. And trust me, it's easier said than done. Like, I've got to remind myself to do that with my team. It's no different at a youth level.
Yeah, that's really interesting. That's really important. Like, we had Dr. Amanda Vizek and Heather Mannix on a couple of webinars ago, and they talked what is fun. And, you know, it was evidence and science that they did that was, you know, trying hard is the number one thing. And, you know, building the positive team dynamics, you know, like, and being wanted, feeling wanted. And that comes right from the coach and the environment that you build, and just like what you're talking about. So I have one more question, and then we'll let you get back to working on your golf game. Okay.
And
if you could tell a younger coach, Jeff Blashill, when he first started coaching, you know, something, or what you know now, what would you tell him?
how lucky you are, how lucky you are every day to have an impact on people, how lucky you are to have that impact and to really cherish that and make sure that's the most important thing you do. You know, I believe in life, like the most important thing to me is the impact I have on people. That would be, you know, how lucky you are to be able to have a, to be able to do something you love, whether it's as a profession or on the side. The other things I would say is always remember what it was like to be a player. Like, I think as a coach, hockey gets easy. Most coaches weren't very good players. Always remember what it was like to be a player. And, you know, I think as a coach, you also kind of have that yesteryear approach where it was way harder when I played and it was way, you know, it's the walk uphill both ways deal. That's total nonsense. It's not true. Like, I do think, you know, there's certain societal things that change, but, you know, your coaches had moments where they didn't like you either. So, like, just always remember what it was like to be a player. I think that's real important when you're a young coach to remember. And I don't know if I was good at it or bad at it. And I do think I always respected the impact that I had on people, but it's tremendous. And you know, I've enjoyed coaching so much, like whether it was the NHL level or whether it was a Team Michigan when we used to take regions to the festivals. I enjoyed it because I loved watching guys get better. I loved watching the team get better. I loved having a chance to have an impact on their lives and on their careers. And to me, that still remains true today in the NHL. And it's the most important part to me of coaching.
Awesome. This is really, really great. I really, really appreciate your time. Always good to have Goalie Nation on a little bit as part of it. Next week, we have some 4 great guests again. Director of Sports Science for the NTDP, Brian Gallivan. He's going to be on Tuesday and talk about what you can do at home. On Wednesday, we'll have Joel Johnson, who's the women's national team coach and also coaches University of Minnesota women's team. On Thursday, we have Peter Aubrey, who's the development coach for the Chicago Blackhawks goaltender. And on Friday, we have our 2021 World Junior coach and Providence College head coach, Coach Nate Lehman. He's going to be on. So, really, thanks again, Coach Blashill. Really appreciate your time. Hope your golf game gets a little bit better, and we'll see you around the rinks. Thanks, everybody, for joining, and we just want to thank all the first responders, the healthcare workers, and everybody that's, you know, the grocery workers, everybody that's keeping this country going is much appreciated, and we really thank you all. Thank you.
Thank you.